Basically, the whole point is to look cooler and to be faster than the guy next to you. That's it.
When you get hit, quiet down. No need for the talking, the fuck is that about?
And welcome back to J.E.T. Film. I'm John, I'm the filmmaker, I'm the owner and builder of this bike. We're gonna be talking about a subject that's been beaten to death. That's engine build on twin cam. So I'm down at a bike show in Lower Westchester last summer. Run into this mechanic that I've already used before. His name is Panhead Andy. It does not get any more old school Harley mechanic name than that. So he's like, man, I love this bike. He's like, what'd you do to it? I'm like, it's just stage one. I'm thinking about doing cams though. He's like, call me. I'm like, yes, sir. So call him like a week later. He's like, okay, so I have some things I want to run by you to see if you want to do it. All right, so I'm going to put all these engine parts into one sentence. So if you guys want to duplicate the build, this is the sentence to listen to. The fueling 574 cams, the fueling race spec cam plate, race spec oil pump, the Suburban Harley Stage 1 performance heads, the Revolution Performance 107 big bore kit with high compression pistons. Revolution Performance is like basically the only company right now that does Nicosil lined cylinders. Nicosil is a trademarked electrodeposited lipophilic nickel matrix silicon carbide coating for engine components, mainly piston engine cylinder liners. It was introduced by Mail in 1967 and initially developed to allow Wankel engine apex seals to work directly against the aluminum housing. Nicosil ultimately creates better heat dissipation and allows for tighter engine tolerances. And that's pretty much it. Oh, and then of course the dyno tune.
All right, Softail, third round mods. This thing is gonna get crazy.
So I have all the parts now. I'm talking with Panhead Andy and coordinating with Prestige Custom Cycles where he works. Bring the bike down, let him go to town. To one compression, the thing it pops. Oh, you can really hear that compression, especially when it starts up. Just, you know, you get every other twin cam that starts up, it's just got their same old, you know, stage one, and then this thing starts. It really shows the difference when you go high compression with cams. It's that is the next level. So it's dyno day.
Yeah, bud, it's dyno day. Heading to Elmsford right now, hoping to capture a little bit of footage of the dyno tuning itself. And then it is off to the races. Here we go.
Oh. it's dyno day at Prestige Custom Cycles. They normally do not let anybody sit in on a dyno tuning session. Made an exception because I basically got on my knees in the store and begged to get footage of it. So they allowed me, and man, it was really cool. Andy is not only an experienced engine builder, but he's also an experienced dyno tuner. Give me the ins and outs of, you know, kind of how it works.
So I'm gonna do some light tuning and probably not start data logging so I can bring it into the parameters where the engine will run somewhere in the area where I want it to be at the end before I actually start tuning.
Get it to perform optimally when you're not under full throttle. That way it still has road manners. And in the meantime, you know, you're kind of breaking the engine in. So the bike was putting out enough power to where it was running over the clutch. So the day was getting late, and Andy said, we're gonna have to adjust your clutch tomorrow or the next day, whenever. I know there was some bad weather the next day. So he adjusts it, gets through the dyno, gives me the numbers, I come and pick it up. He's like, but just so you know, this is an early sign, but adjusting the clutch, it's just a band-aid. The clutch is gonna go, and it's probably gonna go when you're at a show or something. So he's like, I would just do a clutch. He's like, you got this nice new motor, do a nice new clutch. Now the numbers weren't exactly what I was hoping for. The look of the bike takes absolute priority over everything else, and that includes performance.
Now, although the intake and exhaust look awesome for this build, they're not meant for max horsepower.
I knew I was gonna lose some. I just didn't think it was gonna be so much.
And just for comparison, the Milwaukee 8114 dyno-tuned stock makes 84 horsepower and 106 torque. The 117 makes 93 horsepower and 108 torque. Bring it on.
But when you get on the bike, and forget about the numbers, you get on the bike and just ride. Compared to what I was, holy fuck. That's really what matters. It's not so much the numbers that you're putting out, it's where you're coming from. So if the bike was putting out 65 horsepower with just my petty stage one, now it's putting out 90. I mean, that's 25 more horsepower. That's quite a jump. the cams are the personality of the engine. Everything else does have some kind of a, you know, an effect. So if you want, you know, a real torquer, or you want a screamer, or you want something that's really strong in the mid-range, which I was told, that's truly what I'm gonna want. Like in the end, yeah, everybody wants that like maximum horsepower at 6,000 RPM. But it took a little bit of convincing for Andy. After a while, it really sunk in. He's like, how often are you really at 6,000 RPM? He's like, you want big power where you use it, where you are a lot of the time. And yeah, granted, I'm not at 4,500 a lot, but I'm at 4,500 a lot more than I would be at 6,000 RPM. So let's talk about sound. Now in New York, we just got a replacement governor because our last governor got the boot. Now this governor now set, it was like one of the first things she did was put into place this new exhaust law. If you tamper with your exhaust, or if a business tampers with somebody's exhaust, you are subject to a fine that's pretty much quadruple of what it used to be.
Others who feel that they have the ability to assault people in their community with the loud drag racing noise and these loud mufflers on their motorcycles and cars, they seem to not care about other people. And now we're giving them a message. You need to care, or else there are financial consequences.
Fuck you, Hutchel. Let's put a scenario in your head. 4,000 RPM and you let off. Right, the down rev is so clackety, raspy, it's straight up lock up your daughters. The dog's in town. Honestly, there is no fucking with the down rev. It is so deafening. It's just the ultimate fuck you to everybody. I read somewhere that somebody put cams on their bike and it made it twice as loud. I'm like, well, I want my bike to be twice as loud. Hopefully this works. And I wanted the lope, just like everybody else. You want that choppy, lopey idle. And that was one of the things that I went over with Andy. I'm like, look, these 574s, I want some overlap. I want these things. And he's like, don't worry, you can get plenty of lope. Now, cold start, there's not much lope. It's only when the engine starts to warm up is when the lope starts to come in.
That's how you do Cholo.
And a hot start can be a little funny. Once in a while, it almost sounds like it wants to just stall out, or it's just really lugging. Apparently with a big cam, that's normal. You know, anybody that says they did a full engine build for like $4,000, 4,500 is fucking lying. Okay, so the remote oil filter. So cool. I ended up finding it on DK Customs. Been on their website many times. For some reason, this time I happened to stumble on this remote oil filter and I looked at the pictures. I'm like, I gotta have it. So it gives you some options, you know, what colors you want, whatever. And then you can do stainless braided lines if you want. You can do line ends to really button it up and make it neat. So I got all of that. Then on top of the oil filter system, there's threading meant for an oil pressure gauge if you want to put one there. So I'm like, wow, that would look really sick. So I start looking around for oil pressure gauges. I'm finding tons of them, and all of a sudden, I find the brass one. Now, of course, DIY Cycles makes it. It's a company I've used many, many times for my brass stuff. So I got that. It was only 30 bucks. Screwed right on. I ended up getting, separately, I got an elbow. It's at a 45 degree. That way it kind of points up at you. Now, you really can't see it while you're riding, not a big deal. I don't really care. It just looks really cool when the bike starts up, and you know, you can see the. You know, does it really do anything? It works. Is it a gimmick? Kind of. Does it look awesome? Yeah. Would I do it again? Absolutely. Okay, so I did a couple engine covers if you guys haven't noticed. The cam cover and the rocker box covers. Cam cover is made by Eddie Trotta. Now, I love Eddie Trotta stuff. They got pretty much everything they make is like the best looking stuff on the market. This was one of their more simple designs because I didn't want to get too funky with a brand new kind of design. Okay, rocker box covers. A while back, I had seen Panhead style rocker box covers for the twin cam. Immediately thought that is the coolest thing I have ever seen. Yes. Yup. That's gonna happen. So I go on the forums to see if anybody else has used these rocker box covers and if they're prone to failure somehow. Of course, one guy chimes in, he says, well, you don't have a panhead, you have a twin cam. And he's like, don't try to be a panhead, be a twin cam. So that sat with me for a while. I'm like, well, there is some truth to that because I do have a twin cam. So maybe I should just try to make my twin cam look like a cooler looking twin cam. And after a couple of years, I'm like, fuck that dude. Fuck it, they look cool. So I ordered up the rocker box covers from some company in like New Hampshire. They're like, when would you like them shipped? I'm like, yes. Not a single person has told me they don't look cool. So underneath these rocker covers is what's called a D-ring. It's basically where the rocker cover connects on top. And I've seen a lot of people actually powder coat this D-ring, the similar way to how they're coloring the ring underneath the rocker cover on the new Milwaukee 8s. Thought that it was very cool. It's just a chance to add more color. All right, you Softail guys know that for each one of your fishtails, you have an exhaust support. All right, with my Samsons, I got these black supports. They're fine, they do their job. Not really much to it. You don't really notice it until you put on Steady Custom Cycles, half inch beefy chrome exhaust supports. When I put them on, all of a sudden I just started noticing it all the time. You can get it with these chrome beefy spacers. You can get it with the with all the hardware you need to mount it. It's just that extra thing to bring you from here to here. Check it out, Steady Custom Cycles. I really like their stuff. They're on to something. They make some of the sickest fishtails. I have their fishtails. They're 42 inch, which are actually 40s on this bike. I've been using them for a while. I got them on the Road King as well. If I were to do the engine build again, knowing what I know now, the only thing I think I would change would probably be the heads. And it's not necessarily different heads. It would be, I would take the heads that I bought from Suburban Harley, the Stage 1 performance heads, and have them mill them down ever so slightly just to gain just a little bit more compression. But even so, it may not have worked. It may have led to a blown motor because my combustion chamber pressure is already pretty much at the max for a twin cam of this kind of build. That's pretty much it. So yes, I am very happy with it. And yes, I know I could have gotten more power. but I would have had to sacrifice the looks that I've been spending so much time on building. So with that, guys, thanks again. See you soon.